Oh, man, they let the worship leader take the pulpit. What's going to happen? What's going to happen? Well, we're about to find out, I guess. I am so thankful to be here. If I haven't had the privilege of meeting you in person, my name is Eddie Hoagland. I'm the worship pastor here at this campus. Also have the privilege of serving as a lead pastor of worship and production now at Harvest. And love getting together with God's people every single week, and we lift high the name of Jesus together. Love what we get to do. And I know what my job is here this morning. It's the same job that Paul gave Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, where he told him, he said, preach the word. Preach. So to preach means to herald, to bring the message from the king, right? If you think of it that way, to herald the message. And what's the message? It's the word. What God wants me to do is just preach the word. I'm not a speechwriter for the king. I can't come up with a better way of saying it. Ultimately, the message has already been written. The speech is already written, and it's in your hands, hopefully. And if you don't have a copy of God's word, it's in the seat in front of you. I want you to be able to see the words that we are studying, because this is the word of God. These are the very words of God. Why do we do that? Because Psalm 19 says that the law of the Lord is perfect. Like, that means that there's nothing I can do to make this better. It is perfect in every single way. And then it says, reviving the soul. It revives your soul. And I don't know about you, but I want that today. I just want to have that sense of newness in my heart. And that's going to come not by the words I say, but the words God has said, that it will revive your soul. And so today I want to talk about worship. No surprise there, right? I want to talk about worship because worshiping God means to ascribe worth to Him. So every single week we gather here in this room, and we call this our worship service. Why? Because the things that we do here as we gather as God's people, meaning the songs that we sing, the giving of our tithes and our offerings, and now what we do together as we stand under the authority of God's word, that we do because we ascribe worth to God, saying, God, you're worth these things. Like, you're worth these things. That's what it means to worship God, to ascribe worth to Him. And I got to tell you, I've had to grow quite a bit in the last few months as a worshiper. God's had to grow me. I think before I used to think, man, it'd be awesome if the Lord showed up. I really want that to happen. And now I'm more in the position where I realize, well, if He doesn't, what are we even doing? We need God to show up. We need Him to show up. If He's not here, what is this? Some sort of weird hobby that these people have that they get in a room together and sing? If He's not here, it's not what we're going after, but He is here. And He does receive the worship of His people. The scripture tells us that He inhabits the praise of His people. That's God telling you that if you praise Him, He's there. He's present. He's aware. And if we were to just rewind, like, I don't know, 6 months. Let's go back to, I don't know, what is it, June now? Yeah, so like somewhere in January. If you would have said, Eddie, here's the next 6 months of your life. It's going to look like this, and then this is going to happen, and this is everything. I could just see it, right, if I had that ability. I could just look at the next 6 months. If you would have offered that to me, I would have kind of been like, yeah, no thanks. Not very interested in that plan. And I would have been like, how can I pass on that? But this is why God's word is a light unto your path and not unto your destination. Do you understand that God doesn't give you all knowledge? He doesn't reveal everything. Why? Because He's the only one who can be trusted with that knowledge. And yet, He gives you His word so that it can light your path. You're not alone in the dark. God says, do these things, and that will give you the next step, and you just keep taking that step. Whatever God's word said, you just keep taking that step, and I am here as a testimony as to the fact that God has been the one guiding my steps. And one of the hardest days of the past few months, I was sitting down with Christina in our living room, and I was just telling her about some of the things I was dealing with and walking through, and I told her, I was like, babe, I don't think I can do this. Like, I don't think I have it. Like, I think this is it, you know? And she looked at me and praised the Lord for a godly wife. She looked at me and said, you're right. You can't do this. But God can do this. God can do this. God can give you the strength. Of course you're not strong enough. Of course you're not strong enough. And instead of spending all our time thinking about how weak we are, instead we should be seeking the strength of God and spending our time with Him and getting time alone with the Father, because that's how we have enough. What's enough? This is where you really start to understand that God's grace is sufficient, meaning as He gives you the things that you don't deserve, it's sufficient. You're able to do the things He calls you to because He will give you what you need. And it's been in our times of worship here as a campus, when I've gotten up here and I've led you in worship, it's been in these sweet times of worship where I've had rest for my soul. Because when I get up there, I'm not performing. I'm in the presence of my Father, and I know this is where I belong, and I can just focus my thoughts on Him, and I don't have to be overwhelmed by everything else that's going on. Because 2019 has been a year like no other, for me at least. And not just what's going on here at our church, but also just with my family, things that have happened there, things that are happened to my friends. There's just a lot. There's just no way around it. 2019 has been rough, but God is faithful, and God is able. And I believe I am still seeing Him move, and glory is what emanates from God's presence. Those are little evidence where you see God's moving, and I'm telling you, I still see that. I still see that today, and I give testimony of that. So we're going to dive into God's Word together, but before we do that, let's just pray. Father, as we seek to hear from You, we're asking that You would make us ready. God, if there's anything that You would reveal to us today that we are not honoring You, we want to change that. We want to do the things that You want us to do. And so we say that we're open, we're listening. And Father, I ask that You would help me be true to this passage. Help me to just explain it clearly and boldly, knowing that You are the one who changes lives, God. We thank You for this opportunity that we get to spend lifting high the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, who is awesome in this place. And we worship Him in the splendor of His holiness, that He's not like us. He's not like us, and that's so awesome how set apart You are, God. You are holy, holy, holy. And we thank You for this time that we get to spend as a church family. And all God's people said, amen, amen. All right, we're going to go to 2 Samuel chapter 24. If you want to turn in your Bibles there, 2 Samuel chapter 24. That's where we're going to be spending the bulk of the message. But I need to give you another verse as to why are we even going there. So Romans chapter 12, verse 1, I actually have this on the screen. You can look at it there. It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Now, notice that picture, to present yourself as a living sacrifice. It's referencing like an altar, a sacrifice in the Old Testament. And it's a beautiful picture, but here Paul is giving us this illustration, and yet he's using a term we haven't heard before, living sacrifice. Well, that's new. Why? Well, that's actually an oxymoron, right? Like, think about it. If the animal gets placed on the altar and then the fire consumes the animal, don't think that animal's alive anymore. And yet here what he's telling us is you offer yourselves as a living sacrifice, that your behavior would be that of the animal that is sacrificed, sacrificial, and yet that you would live in it, that you would walk in that, that you would be a living sacrifice. And notice what he says, holy and acceptable to God. Holy, what does it mean to be holy? To be holy is to be set apart. And if you are a child of God, you have been set apart because of the things that God has done. And the things that God has declared you to be, you're set apart, you're His. You belong to Him, because if you've turned away from your sin and embraced Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are now holy. And when God looks at you, He sees the righteousness of Jesus Himself, and that's been given to you. And that's what makes you holy. And then what does He say? He says, acceptable to God. Well, what's it mean to be acceptable to God? It's a simple principle, but it's profound. That God will receive the things He has requested. And as we seek to be a living sacrifice, we will become the things that God wants to receive, that He's asked us to be, and in so we would be acceptable to God. And then He says, which is your spiritual worship. Spiritual, not physical. So we're not talking about a living sacrifice that's physical, building an altar that's physical here on the stage. We're talking about a spiritual altar. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. Building an altar of worship. Building an altar of worship. How do we become that living sacrifice that Paul told the church in Rome to become? How do we become that? Well, I'm not a pro altar builder myself, and so I figured that we should probably talk to someone who's even built an altar. I've never done that in my life, but thankfully we have everything pertaining to life and godliness right here within this book, and we're going to receive our instruction from David. So now that's why we're going to 2 Samuel chapter 24, and we're going to start in verse 18. But before we get there, I got to give you at least a little bit of context of like, where are we jumping in here? What's going on? So this is David, King David now, but you remember David, right? David the shepherd, and then David and Goliath, David and Bathsheba. You know some of those stories maybe. And now he's David the king of Israel. This is towards the end of his life. This is the end of the book of 2 Samuel. And what happens at the beginning of the chapter is that David sins against the Lord by sending Joab to complete a census of all the warriors of Israel. And the reason we know that it was sin is because David acknowledges it was sin within the passage. And then as I studied that, I was like, I see that David sees that it's sin, but I don't really understand why is it such a big deal to complete the census. Well, there's a couple of reasons. One is God not only cares about the what, like what we do, he also cares about how we do it. And if you study the parallel passage in 1 Chronicles chapter 21, you actually find out that they left out two of the tribes. So they didn't even do the census in the right way because they leave out Levi and Benjamin. And not only that, but I think even more, it reveals that David was not relying upon the Lord. He was now starting to just count his armies and be like, this is how strong we are. He was using these eyes instead of these eyes. And in so, he stopped relying upon the Lord, and he began to act like what history would tell us, a behavior of a Near Eastern king during that time, that they would just count their armies all the time. Why? To tout their power. They would have a sense of security within their power. But we are to rely upon the Lord. And then here's what happens is David realizes he sinned. The scripture says that his heart struck him. I can't skip over that. That is beautiful and that is awesome. His heart struck him, because this is the same David who, when he sins with Bathsheba, the Lord has to send Nathan, the prophet, to rebuke him and to call him towards repentance. And what happens in this passage? No prophet. David realizes it. No need for a prophet, because his heart struck him and he realized that he had sinned against God. And David was a great king, not because of all the choices he made. David was a great king because he was a repentant king. See, Saul, he confessed his sin when he got caught, but David repented. He repented, and here when he sins against the Lord, then what happens is the Lord offers him three options for judgment. I can't imagine what this would have been like, to be offered by the Lord. Like, here are your three options as a judgment for your sin, and the three options he gives him is 3 years of famine, or 3 months of being chased by your enemies, or 3 days of pestilence. And as David considers the things, the scripture says that he was greatly distressed. No kidding. I can't imagine what that would have been like. And yet here he reveals his heart, and what does he choose to do? He chooses to put himself in the hands of the Lord, giving us the understanding that I think he just removed that option of 3 months of being chased by my enemies. Why? Because he knew that God is merciful and that man is just not. And if he was going to put himself in someone's hand, didn't want to put himself in the enemy's hands, instead he said, just Lord, whatever you would bring, I know that I want to be in your hands because you are merciful and I am not. So then the judgment of the Lord is pestilence for 3 days, and the angel of the Lord goes to execute this judgment, and 70,000 men die. Boom. Like that. Like 70,000 men die, which that's just the men. How many total people die? We don't know, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be over 100,000 people die right away. And then the angel of the Lord gets up to Jerusalem now, comes up to Jerusalem, and then there's a slow pause right there. And that's where we're jumping in. So you sense the tension of what's happening? Right before verse 18, the judgment of the Lord is coming to Jerusalem, and then this happens. So verse 18, it says, and Gad came that day to David. So Gad is David's seer, meaning this is how the Lord communicated with David. Gad came that day to David and said to him, go up, raise an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite. So David went up at Gad's word, as the Lord commanded. And when Araunah looked down, he saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Araunah went out and paid homage to the king with his face to the ground. And Araunah said, why has my lord the king come to his servant? David said, to buy the threshing floor from you in order to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague may be averted from the people. That the plague may be averted from the people. What David is seeking is God's mercy. And this is where it all begins, that we seek the mercy of God. Point one, as we build our altar of worship, as Paul is telling us to do, as we build our altar of worship, what do we learn from David building this altar? What are the things that we learn? Well, it started with this. Why did he build the altar? He was seeking the mercy of God. Mercy is when God withholds the things that we deserve. That's what mercy is. God withholding the things that we deserve because of our actions. And as we begin to build our altar of worship, you have to have a deep understanding and awareness that you need God's mercy. And he is withholding the things that we deserve. What do we deserve? We deserve death. We deserve condemnation. We deserve judgment. And yet we're sitting here today worshiping his son, Jesus Christ. Why? Because God is being merciful to us. He's being merciful to you right now. He's still being merciful to you. And this is where it starts making more sense to me, right? That we enter his gates with thanksgiving. Why thanksgiving? Why at the beginning entering into his gates with thanksgiving? Well, that's because the greater our sense of our need for mercy, the greater our thankfulness. The greater you realize that you need God to withhold those things. And then as he does, what's our response? Thankfulness. Makes perfect sense that we would enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise because we're thankful for the fact that God is withholding the things that we deserve. And you know, I think this is a little harder sometimes for us in modern day to understand, whereas the people of Israel, they really, really understood this concept very well. They're the people who saw the Red Sea split. They're the people who saw the earth open up and the sons of Korah get swallowed up. I mean, they have seen the judgment of the Lord, and they knew they were to seek the mercy of the Lord. And the judgment of the Lord is towards us too, and we need the same mercy, just like they did. And we need to be aware of our need of mercy. But then the passage continues, verse 22. It says, "Then Araunah said to David, 'Let my lord the king take and offer up what seems good to him. Here are the oxen and the burnt for the burnt offering, and the threshing sledges and the yokes of the oxen for the wood. All this, O king, Araunah gives to the king.' And Araunah said to the king, 'May the Lord your God accept you.'" It's a nice parallel, right, between Romans chapter 12 and what we're reading, that we would be acceptable to God. "May the Lord your God accept you." And let me just pause right there. So we're going to see David's response in a second, but let's just catch up again. What's happening? It's really interesting. Araunah says, "I give this to the king," but David said, "I came to buy it," right? Notice it, it's right within the passage. He said, "I came to buy," and Araunah's response is, "I'm just going to give it to you, and I'm not just going to give you the piece of land that you need. I also am going to give you all like the materials, like the things that you need." And I don't know exactly what Araunah's motivation was, but if I'm in his shoes, I see the angel of the Lord now coming to Jerusalem. I'm like, let's build this altar. Let's seek the mercy of God. Let's see if he'll be merciful to us. So here's the land. Here's the stuff. Like, let's just get this process going. And yet David is going to say no. That's so amazing to me. And that, this is where we see the heart of a worshiper. He's going to say no. And so what? Why does he say no? Well, it's right there in the passage. Look at that. Verse 24. "But the king said to Araunah, 'No, but I will buy it from you for a price. I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing.' So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver." I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing. I'm not going to do it. That's what David says. I'm just not going to do it. It's got to cost me something, because David understood our second point, which is you not only seek the mercy of God, but then you give of yourself sacrificially. You give of yourself sacrificially. Do you know that the heart of a worshiper is not a heart of minimalism? Like, you shouldn't be thinking in that way if you want to worship God. You shouldn't be thinking, what's the bare minimum, God, that I need to do to be like, I count as a worshiper? Like, what's the entry level? That's not the heart of a worshiper. A heart of a worshiper is not a heart of minimalism. It's actually quite the opposite. It's what more can I do, God? Like, what more could I bring to you? More of you, less of me. More of you, less of me. That's the heart of a worshiper, because worship calls you beyond the threshold of your personal preference. It calls you beyond those things. So imagine it this way. So there's a circle around you, and anything within your reach would be your preference. And so these are the things I want to do. These are the things I don't want to do. All the preferences that you might have. Worshiping God means you go beyond that circle into new territory, where you stop thinking about the things you want and you start thinking about, does God want this? What does God ask of us? And worship calls you to leave that limit of your personal preference and enter into the area of sacrificial worship, offering up things to God that cost you something. Because that is what we want to do. We want to give of ourselves sacrificially. You know, I've talked with a bunch of people, and the topic is always like, what's happening in our worship services the past few months? Like, why do you sense that the temperature of our worship is increasing? And I've talked with a bunch of people, and I don't pretend to have all the answers, but could I just suggest to you maybe the reason the temperature in our worship services are going up is because it's costing us more now? It's costing us more to sing. It's costing us more to bring this offering of worship that we bring to God. I know it's costing me more. It's definitely not as easy as what it was a year ago to stand up on that stage and lead you in worship. But I think it's okay, because God deserves everything we bring to him. And if it costs us more, that's actually a good thing, because then it's sacrificial. And we should not want to offer things to God that cost us nothing. That is not the heart of a worshiper. So then the question is, how do we offer God our worship, right? These are our worship services, what we're bringing to God. How do we do that if we want to give of ourselves sacrificially? Well, a couple things I think of. One, we should show up early enough to be in this room when we're going to bring our worship to God. And I get it. That's not an easy task, right? Like, we have Danielle and Rafa, 6 and 4, and it's work. It's work to get here. And I get it. This morning, you know, Christina's serving on the worship team this morning. So then I wake up at like, I don't know, 6 something. They come barging in my room and they're like trying to get ready. I got to get them ready. I got to get myself ready. I got to think through my sermon notes. It's okay. I get it. It's work. But it's okay that it's hard. Why? Because this is the worship of God. And I would give anything to worship God. And if that's my priority, then I'm going to get here early enough to be able to check him into Harvest Kids so that I can be in the room, not to please any person, a worship leader, a pastor. That's not what I'm saying. I want to be in this room. Why? Because what do we do here? We worship Jesus Christ. And so I want to be here for that, and I want to give of myself, and I don't want to give him something that just costs me nothing. You know, whatever's convenient, whatever's easy. That's not the mentality of a worshiper. A worshiper wants to give something to God that costs him something. And so we not only show up early, but we also don't leave early. Like, I get it. Look, when service is dismissed and then we all run to our cars, and there's people who, like, you know, they set their lunch reservation for 12:32 because they thought that was a great idea, you know? Just like, we gotta go, gotta get to lunch. You know, it's like, run, everybody run. And there's a sense of like, we gotta go. And then some people would even leave early. And I get it, it's inconvenient. I understand that. But what I'm saying is, it's okay that it's inconvenient, because it's a sacrifice that we're willing to make for the worship of Jesus. And I want everything God has for me every single Sunday. I don't want to miss out just because I had an idea of something else I wanted to do. I want to have everything God has in store for us every week. And so I show up early and I focus my heart and I don't leave early. So then what are the offerings of worship? Well, here, I'm going to give you 5 of them. 5 offerings of sacrificial worship. As we seek to build our altar of worship, what are 5 offerings that we can give of the Lord sacrificially? There are many more. There are many more that I could have brought, but these are the ones I just felt led to share with you this weekend. 5 offerings of sacrificial worship. The first one is singing. Psalm 96, verse 1 says, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord all the earth." Now, that in Hebrew, that's the word shir, which means to sing. So nothing complex there. It means what it means. And notice he says, sing to the Lord all the earth. So it seems to be that if you live on planet Earth, this verse applies to you. Okay? So I think we all qualify for the people that God wants to sing. Do you understand how awesome that is? That the God of the universe, who made you, knows you by name, keeps your tears in a bottle, knows the hairs on your head, who knows you, he wants you to sing to him. That is awesome. God wants you to sing to him. You know, I as many of you know, I grew up in Mexico City, Mexico. My dad's a pastor there. I'm a missionary kid. And I started leading worship at big church when I was 15 years old. And I don't think I was quite ready, But it was kind of like, well, you play guitar and you kind of sing, so you got the job, you know, like, go, lead us in worship. And there wasn't much competition for that role in our church. And so it was just like, boom, I'm 15 years old. I'm the worship leader of the church. And I acted like a 15-year-old did, right? There was not tons of wisdom in some of the actions some of the things I was doing. And one of those things that was just unwise, it was just not wise, is I was leading worship, and I would look out there, and I see one of my friends, and I'd be like, oh, he's not singing. Well, that doesn't make sense. Like, why is he not singing? And so as an unwise worship leader, I went and talked to him. And the reason that's not wise, just so you know, is because if I tell you that that's what worship leaders do, then everyone's like freaking out. They're like, what? We're being judged every single weekend? No, that's not what we're doing. Don't worry. We don't assess everyone individually. That's not happening. There's a lot more wisdom in what we're doing these days, and thankful for the team that leads us. But just as an unwise 15-year-old, I went to him and I just talked to him after service. And I was like, hey, I noticed you don't sing in church. Why? And he was just like, what? Like, and his answer was ultimately, yeah, it's just not me. Like, that's not me. I'm not a singer. I don't like singing. And I was like, okay, so we just left it at that. And he was my friend, so I guess there was a little leeway that I could ask him that. And but then it got really interesting to me, because then we go to a concert of one of his favorite bands, and he's like singing like no one else. And then I was like, okay, interesting. So you'll sing there. And then we go to a birthday party with his nephew, and he's singing happy birthday to that kid. And I'm like, so you're willing to sing to a kid, but what's going on? Like, what's happening that makes you stop when you get to the worship of Jesus Christ? And what's stopping him is that threshold of personal preference. It's not me. It's not me. But here's the thing. Worship calls you beyond that threshold into the things that God wants. And it should be enough that if you are his and God says, I want you to sing, that should be enough. And if you're like, I don't want to sing, it's not me, that's okay. Look, you don't have to sing anywhere else. I'm just telling you, you don't have to sing anywhere. You want to go to a birthday party with your nephew and you want to skip singing happy birthday, that's between you and that kid. Like, whatever you guys want to argue over, if he wants that song, that's between you and that kid. But when it comes to church and when it comes to worshiping Jesus, you should sing. Because he wants you to sing. God the Father has told us that he wants us to sing as his children. So not just singing. Next word is, the next offering of sacrificial worship is shouting. Shouting. Psalm 66:1 says this, shout for joy to God, all the earth. Oh man, we can't get out of this one either. See, when you preach these things, you learn a lot about people. Everyone's kind of, you can just sense it. Oh, there's an exception to that. I think I'm the exception. Like, there's an exception. You want to move off planet Earth? Then you can be the exception. But it turns out God says, shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. That word shout in that verse is the word ruah. Which, a little side note, anytime I say a word in Hebrew, I try to use my Spanish accent because then people think I know what I'm talking about. It just sounds more official. But I don't speak Hebrew. But I do know what this word means, which is, it means to cry out greatly, to split the ears with sound. I don't even know what that means, but it sounds powerful to me. To raise the war cry, to cheer, and to shout in triumph. To shout in triumph. And I get it. Look, we all grew up in different families, right? Everybody grew up in a different scenario. And I grew up in a family where, like, if you were to come to dinner, what we call talking, you'd be like, that's shouting. Like, that is not talking. Why are you guys so mad? And we're like, we're not mad. We love each other. Like, this is just how we talk to each other. And then on the other side of the spectrum, I've been over, you know, families that are, they're just so soft-spoken. It's just like, hey, it's good to see you. We're so glad you're here. And then when you sit at that dinner table, like, the sizzling of the food is louder than the whisperous prayer that's somewhere around in the room. It's just like everything's so calm and collected. And there's nothing wrong with that. Absolutely nothing wrong with being soft-spoken. But what I'm saying is, even to those people, God knows you. God knows what family you grew up in. God knows everything about you. And yet he wants you to shout. He wants this from you. And he's the one asking you to shout. But not just shout, just to make noise. What does it say? Shout for joy to God. Shout for joy. Do you understand that if you have Jesus, you win? Like, if you have Jesus Christ, no matter what you've lost in this life, you win, and you have a reason to shout in triumph. Because in him, you have found all the blessings that you will ever enjoy. Every good and perfect gift comes from God himself. And that should drive you to, yes, raise your voice. And yes, even get to the point where it's a shout. Because God says, shout for joy to God, all the earth. Then, all right, so that's our second one. After that, next word, clapping. Clapping. Psalm 47, verse 1 says, clap your hands, all peoples. Oh, man. We're not going to get out of this one either. All peoples? No, some peoples. Clap your hands. No, that's not what God's word says. It says, clap your hands, all peoples. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. The word there for clap is the word takah, which means to strike your hands together. And the root of that word is actually comes from thinking about a trumpet blast. So if a trumpet just went boom, it's the equivalent of that, but with our hands, where we're going boom, we're striking them together to make a clapping sound. That's what that word means. And now back to Eddie, the 15-year-old worship leader in Mexico. Now, my dad's a pastor, and he never preached, like, don't clap. Never was a part of the sermon. And no leader ever said anything of the sort. But if you came to our church, you'd stand there and you'd be like, yeah, we don't clap here, for sure. Like, no one's clapping. It just was kind of cultural. Like, we don't clap at this church. And but then I start leading worship, and I start finding these verses, and I'm like, well, I don't really have a reason to say, like, why aren't we allowed to clap? And you guys remember this? There's a worship song in the early 2000s. It went, we want to see Jesus lifted high, a banner that... I'm not getting a lot of response, so probably not. Maybe there's a few of you who do. Okay, a couple thumbs up. Well, if you remember that song, in the chorus, you go, we want to see... We want to see. Hey, all right. Some of you know this song. Lots changed since the early 2000s. We're not as coordinated with our clapping these days. It's a lot more freeform. But in that song, in that chorus, you're supposed to clap three times after that phrase. And so I'm leading worship. I'm with the youth choir behind me. And we're singing this song. And I know that in the chorus, we're going to clap three times. And I'm just like, oh, man. It's here we go. We're going to clap for the first time in this church. And I was so nervous because I'm like, queremos a Cristo. So I'm singing the verse, proclamar común. And then as I'm singing the verse, I just start sweating bullets. Like, I am so nervous. I'm like, what's about to happen? Are people just going to be like, we're out? We're out. Like, what is going on here? And I got so nervous. And then we get to the chorus. Then we clap. No one left. It all worked out. But it wasn't really the right way of doing it. What I was doing is just, like, start doing things that were different. That's not the best way. The best way of doing it, the wise way of doing these things, is to actually teach it, what I'm doing right now, and showing you that God's word says that we should clap to him. Why is that so important? Because if you don't teach that it's from God's word, then people are going to start thinking that it's like a fad. Like, well, the clapping things, it's here for a while. Man, it'll just change. You know, give it 10 years. Like, people will stop clapping. Or even worse, you'll start thinking that it's a generational thing. Like, oh, the young people, they just love clapping to the Lord. This isn't generational. This is what God has said. It has nothing to do with how old you are. It doesn't matter if you're 18 or 81. It does not matter, because these are the things that God has asked for. And I've seen it time and time again, that God doesn't bless a style of music. God doesn't bless some band over another. God blesses his word. And if we do the things that God is asking us to do, he will bless it. He doesn't care anything about style of music. Go ahead, try to study the Psalms. What do we find? Rock music, salsa music? It's not in there. He doesn't care about those things. He cares about receiving the things he has asked us to bring. And clapping is one of those things. Clapping, shouting, singing. And now the fourth one, dancing. Ooh, just got controversial in here. Oh, man. We like talking about the other ones, but now it's like, oh, it's dancing. You can't talk about dancing in church, Eddie. What are you doing? Well, here's what I'd like to do. I'd like to talk about dancing as much as the Lord talks about dancing. And Psalm 149, verse 3 says, let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with the tambourine and lyre. So don't be fooled by the tense in the English. Let them praise his name. It's not like, give permission if someone would like to, right? Because again, I can hear that, like, we're the exception. I'm the exception. Well, a better way of reading that is, let it be so that they praise his name with dancing. May it be so that they praise his name with dancing. That word dancing is the word machol. which means to twist or whirl. To dance, including physical movements of various sorts, a joyful trembling in worship. This is what God's calling. Let them praise his name with that, with machol. And now notice, he says, including physical movements of various sorts. So it's not like God says, hey, there's this one version of the Macarena, and that's worship. Like, that's not what God's saying. It's not a specific thing. It's a various sorts. He's just saying there's motion. There's motion in worship. It doesn't have to be like, all right, worship starting, left foot here, right foot here. I'll see you in 30 minutes because those aren't moving anywhere. That there's motion in worship, and all that motion would be dancing. It would be machol, the thing that God is asking for. When you're studying a word in the Hebrew, one of the most useful things to do is to study the root, and then because the root leads you to all other words, and then you can kind of understand it better when you're studying a foreign language. And so when we study the root of machol, it has a negative connotation. The negative version of this word means writhing as with pain. Writhing as with pain. And this is so useful to understand what is actually happening here in machol. Writhing as with pain. It even actually references labor pain. Like the pain of what that means, the writhing in pain. Now, I have not given birth to any child, nor will I. So I have to find something else that makes me writhe in pain to be able to understand this. And for me, one of the ways, when I thought of writhing in pain, I thought of stubbing my toe. That's like writhing in pain for me. We moved here 9 years ago, and we didn't have a bed. And so we go over to IKEA in Schaumburg, which IKEA is pretty great. Why? Because you spend about $250, $300, and you get a bed. Now, what they don't tell you is you're going to have to spend 8 hours assembling said bed. And then after you spend 8 hours building the bed, then you have to spend 2 hours going backwards in the steps to get to the step that you messed up and then fix that step. And then you're going to spend a couple more hours just finishing the bed. Turns out I'm not great at following Swedish pictures. I'm better at like words. English words would be a lot more helpful for me. So, but you know, it's $250. You get what you pay for. And it looks awesome. It looks modern, but I'm like, I don't really know where it starts, ends. I'm pretty sure I sleep there. You know, and I'm looking at this bed, and it looks great. But then as I'm walking to the bed, because I don't fully understand it, I stub my toe right on the corner. And I've seen different people respond different ways to that. Certain people, when they have that much pain, they just start running in circles like a crazy person, like just like running around. What is happening? Just slow down. Tell me what happened. I don't even know what happened, and you're just running, you know? And then I'm a little bit more introverted personally. So for me, when I stub my toe, it's like I hit it and then I'm like, and I like bend over. I enter into the fetal position because it hurts so bad. Oh my goodness. And it's not just like my toe hurts. It's like Eddie hurts. Everything about me is pain because the pain is so great that I can't stay still. Because the pain is so great that I can't stay still. And could it be that the joy of the Lord would get to be so great in your heart that you just can't stay still? That you would be writhing, but with joy, and knowing that the motion that comes out of it, the joy is so great as you give testimony to yourself of the faithfulness of God and how awesome he's been, that you just can't stay still. And God wants that. God says he wants that. And I want to give it to him because he wants it. The last offering of sacrificial worship is raising hands, the raising of hands. Psalm 143, verse 6 says, I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like a parched land. Selah. I stretch out my hands to you. That's the word paros, which just means to spread out or stretch over. Here it's very clear that it's an expression of need, right? I stretch out my hands to you as in a parched land. And maybe you walked into church today and you're in that parched land. Could it be that your offering of sacrificial worship would just be to raise your hands to God and tell him, I need you, God. I need you. And that's not the only expression of raising your hands. Another psalm says, lift up your hands to the holy place and bless the Lord. So it could also be an expression of just saying, God, I just want to bless you. I want to honor you. This is why I'm raising my hands. As you can imagine, if I grew up in a church that didn't do much shouting, clapping, there wasn't much raising of hands either. And side note, my home church in Mexico, they've grown so much in these things. I mean, if you saw how they're worshiping the Lord now, you'd be amazed, right? But back then, this was just a little different. The Lord was still growing us. And so I'd never raised my hands ever in worship. And I went to Liberty to get my worship degree because the Lord had called me to, amen. the Lord had called me to ministry. And so I'm at Liberty University getting my worship degree, and they would lead worship at the beginning of every class. And as I start finding these verses in scripture, I'm like, man, I guess I should be raising my hands, right? Like, if this is what God wants, I should be doing it. And so I just made the choice, and I said, all right, Lord, I'm gonna go to class this day, and I'm going to raise my hands to worship you. So then I go to the class, and I sit in the back row. You better believe I sat in the back row. And I'd never done this, and they start leading worship, and all that's in my mind is just, wait, what's the right way? Is there a right way? Is there? Like, all these questions start jumping in, and I just felt the Lord tell me, like, Eddie, you're just overthinking it. Like, just do the things I've asked. And so I wasn't feeling it. It wasn't like an experience for me. It was just simply like, okay, then, and they're up, you know, just like, it wasn't anything complex. And then just put my hands up in the air. And I'm just telling you, it wasn't that significant to me in regards to my experience that day, but man, was it significant to me in regards to my obedience of the Lord and how much he delighted in the fact that even though I wasn't feeling it, even though it felt awkward, super awkward to me, he received it. Why? Because it was beyond my threshold of personal preference, and it was the thing he wanted. And now you can never see me worshiping the Lord without my hands in the air. That's changed a lot. But I'm just telling you, it didn't start there. It started with, I want to give God the things that he has asked for. So we seek the mercy of God, and then we give of ourselves sacrificially. And finally, verse 25, this is the last verse in the book. Verse 25 of 2 Samuel chapter 24 says, and David built there an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord responded to the plea for the land, and the plague was averted from Israel. When you seek the mercy of God and you give of yourself sacrificially, the last thing you get to do is you get to see the response of the Lord. You get to see the response of the Lord. And here, a plague was averted. A plague was averted. And if you are a child of God, you need to know that a plague has been averted for you as well. That God has had mercy upon you as well. And we get to see the response of the Lord. And that means you get to leave the outcome to God. I'm not standing up here saying, hey, if you do these five things, then God will specifically do this, and this is how he will respond. The response comes from the Lord, and we leave it in his hands because he's the only one who's all-knowing and all-sufficient. He gets it, okay? All we get to choose is to bring our offering of worship. That's the choice you have. Will you sacrifice as you build your altar of worship? Will you give of yourself to the God in a way that you do the things that he's asking from you? Man, when I started studying this passage, I'm just going to tell you, I did not know how big a deal this passage is until further study. And this is awesome. You need to know this, that this is the buying of the threshing floor. David buying the threshing floor from Arana. This is the very same piece of land that Abraham took Isaac up, because the Lord had asked him to offer up Isaac, and the Lord provides a substitution. And the mercy of the Lord is seen there. And then in the same piece of land, now David buys a threshing floor, and we see that a plague is averted from the people of Jerusalem. And that would become the Temple Mount, where David would gather materials and his son Solomon would build his temple. And the glory of God would dwell there. The glory of God would dwell there. And then 100 years after, the Son of God would come into that city. And he would die outside that city as the permanent sacrifice for your sin. Because David built an altar for atonement, and that's just temporary. It's always looking towards Jesus Christ, who is the permanent sacrifice for your sins, the permanent atonement for your sins. Sometimes when you read the Old Testament, it can feel a little distant from you. because it requires some study and understanding. What exactly am I even reading here? And here's an awesome opportunity for you to understand how near that is, that we actually have this in common with them. For they had to have a priest offer up these sacrifices, and here David is performing that priestly duty, giving this altar, performing that sacrifice. And you need to know that we have a priest. And we not only have a priest, but we have a high priest. And we not only have a high priest, but we have the great high priest. Hebrews chapter 4 says, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are. Yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. We worship today with a high priest, and we worship today with a sacrifice that was offered to God. It's like when John the Baptist, when he saw Jesus, what did he say? He said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And today, as we build our altar of worship, we can do that because of the Lamb of God who was offered up to God to bring us back into relationship with him. And so today, seek the mercy of God. Give of yourself sacrificially. And then just see the response of the Lord. See what he does. Back to that first verse I shared with you, Romans 12:1. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, and I appeal to you, Harvest Bible Chapel, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And so the question is, how can you grow as a worshiper? What can you do to grow as a sacrificial worshiper of God? Because as I've been preaching, I just know how it goes. Someone's telling you, you can just hear the voice in your head. Someone's telling you, you know, you're just bad at this. Like, you'll never grow. Like, you're just not going to be good at this. That's for people who like music. That's, you know, there's all these excuses. And I'm just telling you, don't listen to that voice. Listen to the voice that said, hey, you could probably grow in this area. Hey, you could probably grow in this area. And don't be overwhelmed by all the things. If I mention five things, you're like, yeah, I don't do any of them. No, that's God's grace to you. He's not trying to be harsh. Like, a father would never be harsh to a child who's learning how to walk, takes a step, and then falls down. A father wouldn't be harsh to that child. He would be joyful that the child is growing. And if you say, I don't have these things, that's okay. It's God's grace to you today that we're talking about this. The question is, what are you going to do? What are you going to do now? And I just want to encourage you, just pick something. Whatever it is that the Holy Spirit has been leading in your heart, saying, you need to grow here. You need to grow here. Instead of fighting that, instead of trying to be the exception, I'm just pleading with you, just let it go. And let the Lord minister to you and say, yes, God. Yes. Let's just bow our heads and close our eyes for a second here before we finish. And whatever it is that the Lord's leading you, I just want to give you a second and say yes to God. Say, Lord, I'll grow in this if you'll just give me the chance. Give me the opportunity to respond in this way, and I'll do it, God. Father God, you are great. And as we get a greater glimpse of who you are, our hearts have to respond. We just can't help it, because you are great, and you are greatly to be praised. That the words of our mouth would respond to your greatness here today. And God, we just ask, would you grow us as a church? We want to give of ourselves sacrificially. Would you grow us today, God? For you're worthy of that. You're so worthy of that. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, let's stand together, and we're going to respond to the Lord in worship.